I wanted to think a little bit about a story. I know we've talked about being young, black, and gifted, and different books that all of us should have read, and hopefully most of us know about The Very Hungry Caterpillar from Eric Carle. Now, I'm going to use this text because I think it gives us a very good platform to start to think about what it is that we're talking about today. And to do that, I'll also bring my three-year-old daughter with me, Ava. Now, I have a young colleague here from, previous colleague from UVA, so I'm not quite alone. But usually when I'm traveling and doing these speeches with people I don't know, I bring my family because it helps me settle my anxiety. But I did have a little experience with Ava. And Ava loves to read. Well, she loves for me to read to her. And this is one of our favorite books. Now, recently when we read the book, is there anybody not familiar with the story? The Very Hungry Caterpillar? Okay. So, beautiful book. So I'll give you the synopsis, and this is easy to do because it's a children's book. So the idea is, on page one, sun rises, caterpillar is born from an egg. And immediately with the excitement about life and experience, the caterpillar begins to instantly devour everything. For the first 5 days, he eats a ton of fruit, and he's really excited. And on day six, he gets overboard. It goes over, it just outdoes himself. And he goes from chocolate cake to sausage to cheese to pizza to lollipops, and then he gets a bellyache. He goes to sleep, he wakes up the next morning, eats a very big green leaf, and feels better. And at that point, he builds a cocoon around himself, and 2 weeks later, pop, he emerges a beautiful butterfly. Now that's the story. Now there is a page in this book, and I'll try to read it to you verbatim. And you know, I love reading to my daughter because I can sort of embrace these characters. So it says, now he wasn't hungry anymore, and he wasn't a little caterpillar anymore. He was a big, fat caterpillar. Now, when I read that to my daughter, I read it with a lot of emphasis. I said, he was a big, fat caterpillar. And when I said big, her eyes, you know, got wider. And then I said fat, and it was like both eyes really wide. And I said, caterpillar. And then I finished the book, and he was a beautiful butterfly. And at the end, she just looked bewildered. So I said, Ava, what did you make of that? And she says, it wasn't nice to call him big, fat. So in that moment, yeah. I did what most parents would do and say, those weren't my words. I didn't write the book. Eric Carle wrote the book. I just read it. And she gives me this look that children often do, and it looks something like this. It's that look that they're giving you when they're not quite buying what you're selling. So at that point, I have to sort of embrace what I had done. So I said, Ava, you didn't like it when I called him big, fat. And she said, no. So I said, well, what do we do? You don't want me to read the page anymore? And she says, no. So now when I read the book, I say, look at him now. It's a beautiful butterfly. And she is happy as a meadowlark. Now, until she's able to hold both good and bad together at the same time, this is how we'll read. But what's important about this is as early as age three, we have everything we need to recognize good and bad. But more importantly, we have everything we need to become a champion for another. At three, she was a mighty protector of this little caterpillar. Project Rise is about awakening what we already have at birth and wondering about where it goes. It goes dormant. Why? Now, we've been talking about risk and protective factors, and some of those we can control and some of them we can't. The two that I want to try to focus on, because I think they're actually pretty amazing, one of the most troubling risk factors is one that we've been talking about, expectation for discrimination. And I also want to talk about one that is the most protective. And it's not just a protective factor, but it will actually mitigate the damage of the expectation for discrimination, and that is language, communication. Because those are two of the things that I've tried to build into Project Rise. One, acknowledging the experience of discrimination, but also building in opportunities to develop language to work it through. Now, this slide is a pretty complicated slide, and I'm going to try to summarize it as best as I can. I think when we transition into academia, and my first life was as a school counselor, so I love 0 to 5. It's a beautiful age, and I love schooling, and I'll always be in schools as a clinician. But I've watched it many, many, many thousands and thousands of times, watching the excitement young children have going into school. They literally devour everything, all experiences, building blocks, coloring, recess, lunch. They love the fish sticks. They still love the macaroni. They don't at 17, but at least at that point, everything is wonderful. And one of the things that I've also noticed is that teachers love teaching at that age. Now, what I find interesting is that between K and third, this is where most of us, and I know that we are sort of saying we're in the us in this room, but most of us get identified gifted between that age, K and third. After third, the window begins to close. I believe that the students benefit the most from the protective factors of interest, group work, connectedness, encouragement during that time. But something shifts in the fourth grade when that window has closed. Years ago, I built one of my first interventions was a project called Walker Academy. And the project was designed to prevent the impact in young black men of not being identified as gifted. You made reference to this idea of superior to not. That's still true. The language is now above, on, below. And there is something magical that happens once you're not identified, where you lose access to above in math and above in reading. So I became curious about how are these young black men making sense of falling below the line? How are they talking about it? And the thing that I became most intrigued about is around the fourth grade, students become clearly confident about the reasons why they weren't identified. And they begin to attribute most of the difficulties they experience to discrimination. The teachers are racist, the school is racist, the world is racist. That's important to me. Because as early as 8, we now understand that there is something about discrimination that is troubling me. What I also find interesting is that by 6th grade, we're talking about social defeat. Something about 6th grade, where students actually begin to accept that they cannot combat it. Whatever that thing was that happened to me at 3rd grade, where all of a sudden teachers stopped believing in me, teachers stopped moving me into the advanced reading groups, I can't change it. And then they get to 7th grade. And for those of us who have this gifted thing, by 7th grade, you should be taking Algebra 1, right? And those of us in the field know, you know, there's these troubling statistics. For instance, they say if you haven't taken calculus by the time you graduate college, you'll never break the $80,000 threshold. You need to be in STEM kind of things. So as a country, we've tracked people out. If you're not taking Algebra 1 by 7th grade, you don't have access to calculus before, which means you can't be. How are students thinking about this? This is what I'm curious about. How do they make sense of this? This is very important. So now you get all of these young, gifted people who weren't identified because we've acknowledged this morning that it's primarily subjective. Teachers have to recommend testing, but they get tracked out. So they get to 7th grade. They haven't necessarily been included, but they work hard. And they graduate still, top 5, most of the students we have at our universities, top 5% of the class, right? They're gifted. They come to college, and however it's been able to work, they reawakening, they've reawakened the little caterpillar in them. They're very excited. They have dreams of recreating themselves. They have dreams of being very successful. And they open themselves up to devour everything. Right? This is the way this works. What's interesting to me is there are things that are waiting for them. Our equivalents of pizza, sausage, cheese, cake, that's going to give them belly aches. And as higher ed people, we need to acknowledge that. That when you come here, despite your hopefulness, there are things waiting for you. And we, as a university, as an academy, have to help them metabolize it. Now, the first thing I'm going to start with is racism and discrimination, because I already talked that that's one of the most destructive risk factors. It's not predictive. I love that sentence, actually. It's not predictive, but it does create some disturbance. Now, this research is stuff that I do every year. You know, the N is around 1,600, which doesn't sound huge, but that's huge. that's a huge N for the populations we deal with. So one of the things that I can tell you is that each year, they're going to tell me that they've experienced a bias incident from people in the university, in the Charlottesville community. Roughly 30 or so percent of the bias incidents they experienced, they attribute to the community, which includes cops, store clerks, residents, ministers, stores, that kind of stuff. You're just residents. But then they also are going to tell me that 25 to 30% of the bias incidents they come from will come from members of the university community, administrators, faculty, and staff. What I'm going to try to focus on today as I sort of move through this is this gold area. And each time I do this, on average, 41% of my participants tell me they have experienced a bias incident from a peer within 6 months of the survey. 9% will report having experienced a bias incident from a roommate within 6 months, and an additional 3% from an RA. That's important, because it's not a mystery. We know where this is coming from. The vast majority of the bias incidents are perpetrated by peers. That's important. Now, they're going to have some other problems, too. That's just one. But there are lots of problems we know are waiting for them. We've been talking about them all day. The first is, surprising to most of them, but 59% of the people I survey will tell me that they've experienced academic problems 6 months prior to the survey. Now, this is important, because I just mentioned that almost 93, 95% of the students who come to our university were in the top 5% of the class. How is it, though, that about 60% are going to experience academic difficulties? Now, there's this wonderful movie where I think there's some professor up, and he says, if you look to your left and look to your right, look behind you, look in front, one of you is not going to be here by the time you graduate kind of thing. That's sort of a nice statistic, actually, because that's like 25% fail rate. It's much more complicated than that. One of the things that I tell my students is, as they get into stats, I say, you'll understand this idea of normal distribution much better. I say, but let me help you for now. 95% of you, top 5%. On day one of classes, 80% of you will become average or below average. From day one, that's normal distribution. 34% above the mean, 34% below. 64% of you, 68% washed. So that business you're thinking about being 4.0 student is not happening. That's mind-blowing. It's absolutely mind-blowing. And another 20% of you will be way below where you think you should be. And another statistic I tell them is the GPA requirement to be included in the top 20% at our university is a 3.8. So keep that in mind. When you're starting to wonder how people are doing, you need to know the top 20% is a 3.8. Most people are average here. Now, that's important, because it sort of floods into this identity issue. From day one, we actually cause the students to experience a significant loss of identity. And we are responsible for helping them grieve that loss. because that identity development actually transitions, it impacts everything else. So they begin to have roommate problems, they begin to have dating problems, they begin to have social problems, all of this linked to this initial and this tragic loss. And that's important. It's absolutely essential to be thinking about this total stuff. Now, over there in the corner, you know, you do see mental health issues, and I find that it's really intriguing to me that it's a very low frequency. The number of students who identify having anxiety and depression in first year is actually very low. It increases by 23% into the second year. So what has happened? And I'm pretty convinced it's not that it's just some new occurrence, but it is this idea that students are functioning at subclinical, possibly PTSD levels. This idea of all of these problems waiting for them, this worry that somebody's going to do a bias incident against me, is so great that they're constantly functioning under stress. Now, how in the world do black students cope with this is a good question. And I should have started out with this. Let me be clear about this word black. I wrote my dissertation, the last thing I published, mind you. And this is why I haven't published. The title of it was Unifying the Single Experience of Black Doctoral Students in Predominantly White Institutions. Obviously, that was close to home for me. But one of the things that I am very convinced of is this idea of black. Black from 1964 is not at all useful to me thinking about people in 2014. I am utterly convinced. Now, the difficulties I have with my own experience is I'm too young to have been a Black Panther. I wish that I, you know, my friends used to call me Stokely when I was in high school because I was sort of, that's the vibe I was sort of putting out. So I'm too young to have been that, but I'm also not old and young enough to sort of wrap my mind around post-racial identity either. But I'm actually clear that there is some shifting, and we have to be wondering about what that shift is, because black is not the same. So at the University of Virginia, when black, when I use this word black, here's what it means. At the point of applying to our university, if a student clicks black in combination with anything, they are black to me. Simple. So these statistics include African-born blacks, white-born Africans, Caribbean, Afro-Caribbeans, Japanese black, Hispanic black, whatever these things are. This is how it works. So every year in my program, I have students who show up and they're white, but they had a black great-grandfather and they checked black. And they show up in my class with 90% black people and they say, well, is this for me? Did you check black? Yes, it is. Now, so here we go. I digress. So I like this idea of the very hungry caterpillar. How do black students cope? And I want you to be thinking about that little house the caterpillar built around himself, the chrysalis. Because I want to try to introduce this idea I've been thinking about for a while called chrysalis states of mind. Chrysalis states of mind. There is something very interesting to me about this idea of withdrawing inwards. Now, for those of us at Brown and at a university like University of Virginia, where we've sort of commissioned people to think about the impact of slavery on our institutions, we can acknowledge that there are some culturally embedded ways of living that are linked directly to slavery. In this population, this idea of looking to the hills from which cometh my strength, looking inwards toward ancestry, looking inwards for examples, for loved ones, this is culturally embedded. So it's not surprising to me that black students turn inside when they are struggling. So one of the things I want to do is depathologize help-seeking in black students. Because it's not like they're just willy-nilly coping. I've studied this. they actually are making very informed decisions about how they choose to deal. Now, we'll talk more about this, but chrysalis states of mind, turning inwards both to avoid struggling and to grow. So these things are happening. Now, here are some ideas. I mean, if we're going to ask you what are some ways that black students cope, you could probably tell me these examples, right? Those in blue, going to church, support groups, sports, going to parties, right? That's interesting, because most people do these things. But when you look at this, that's nowhere near the vast majority of the ways that they cope. Black students are actually choosing activities that are by definition isolating. When black students cope, they disconnect from others, which has a ton of implications in higher ed. Especially, I think there was a young person, you're the engineer, yes? There is a strong impact, for instance, in engineering students, because you cannot survive as a lone wolf in engineering. It is a death toll. I've seen it a ton of times. Students go in, and the problem is, when you turn inwards in this chrysalis state of mind, you turn inwards, the only thing you can rely on is what is already inside. So if it's not in there, you can't get it. This is a complication of this sort of chrysalis way of coping. But I want to point out a couple of these that I find very interesting, and I've tried to build interventions around these ideas. But when I do this survey, 51% of the people I survey on average tell me they use organizational leadership as a way to cope, which is crazy. And what's also complicated is that in these very competitive institutions, we encourage it. So when the student has that shifting in their identity as a very competent student, they transition into becoming a very competent leader. So before you know it, the student who's on the cusp of getting a C in organic chemistry now has 5 leadership positions. The end result, though, is they're still alone because they are the leader, not a member of the community. It's very tragic. So these things are actually diagnostic. So when somebody comes to me and I see they have 10 things beneath their name as their little monikers in undergrad, that's diagnostic. And I immediately say, let's cut this in half. And their eyes, what are you talking about? It's like, cut it in half. The other, and I do want to acknowledge prayer, because there is a stereotype that black people are religious people. And what's interesting is, even though I think that too has shifted, black people still pray, because they're turning inwards. And in this survey, roughly 58% of the students identify using prayer as a primary coping strategy, which is important, because there is something inside. It might not be organizational religion, but there is something in there that they believe they carry with them. The other thing I want to point out that's pretty exciting and interesting is 71% of the students I survey on average have told me that they have used sleeping as a primary coping strategy within the 6 months prior to the survey. This is absolutely important. Do y'all know why? There was a study published in the summer in sleep. And this study was able to show that dysregulated sleeping too much or too little, is the only independent predictor of whether a freshman will drop or withdraw from a class. That's absolutely essential. So now that we know the harm of sleeping, we might actually be able to build interventions around it. So immediately, when that person comes in with 10 items, I hand them a sleep journal. How are you managing? And when they come back and tell me I get 3 hours of sleep a day, I say, you're probably going to drop a course. And they say, yeah, I was thinking about, and I say, see, this is the problem. Cut those items in half. Sleep more. Now, this is sort of clinician in me. This is how I'm dealing with this stuff. Now, I do want to acknowledge this difficulty. There are drawbacks to this chrysalis way of thinking. There are absolute drawbacks, because students disconnect from others, and we know that there is some usefulness in being connected. But I love this image. It's a very interesting image, and I took this of a picture from a video on YouTube. And it was a beautiful moment. There was a mother and her children and a husband. The mother walked into the garden, and she saw a chrysalis that had fallen from a limb. She went back into the house. She got a sewing pin, took the chrysalis back outside, and reattached it to a tree. That's what that image is. The next morning, she comes out with her husband and kids, and they recorded this butterfly emerging. What I'm going to hopefully suggest here is that we respect the necessity of this chrysalis state of mind and begin to think about how we might intervene around it. Because from my experience, once a student is in that chrysalis way of coping, there's no benefit to pulling them out. The benefit is to either respond prior or immediately after. For those of us who watched butterflies emerge, we know that at the time that they first emerge, the wings haven't spread out, the fluid hasn't distributed through the body, and they're just vulnerable. So if we can recognize when a student is coming out of that way of coping, it's an excellent time to intervene. And if we can get them before, we know that. Now, what I want to try to also debunk is this idea that black students don't reach out. This is wholly not true. The problem is, do you see that colorful spectrum over there to the left? That is the benefactor, the wonderful people we recruit with all of our endowment. This is faculty, staff, administrators, therapists, counselors. These are all of the people we spend all of our resources recruiting. And they only count for about 18% of the help these students receive. Now, I notice you said, we need to get more staff. We need to get more people. How do we do this? You can get 20 new people, and they probably will still account for 18% of the help these students get. Now, that blue is family. 20% or so of the help these students receive will be from family. Now, for those of us on the front line, we have this idea, we know that Johnny is probably not calling home telling mom he's playing beer pong 4 nights a week. Sally is not coming home telling mom that she is doing X number of things, drinking, smoking, gelling, weeding, whatever these things students do. The students don't call home and give the information the parents need to actually give good help. So they're handicapped. So to me, the idea that they're actually looking for family is not that helpful to me. Because what is family going to do besides say, you can do it. You can push through. Grandma's praying for you. This is what they get when they call home. But if the parents knew that all this other stuff was occurring, they might get different interventions. What I'm also going to focus on is that red area. About 70% of the support that students get each year, when they're telling me this survey, and I do it once in the fall, once in the spring, 70% of the help that they receive is from their peers. Students, RAs, black leaders, black friends, non-black friends, friends inside a university, friends outside. But as a university, we are entrusting one of our most precious resources to the least qualified and experienced person on campus. This is it. So it's not that they don't reach out. They just don't reach out to where the data is being collected. But they are actually reaching out before and after the sort of chrysalis way of being. So what are we doing? Peers, to me, is where the money's at. Because peers are actually providing the most service to our students. And that gold is they are doing some of the most destructive activities. Peers, being both helpful and hurtful. So, all of what I just talked about is 6 years worth of research. What's interesting to me is in 2006, four black students went into our chief diversity's officer's office, and they said, simply put, we are all we got. We need to be equipped to help ourselves. They walked in. No data, no analysis, no PhD. That's what they walked in and said. And after we did some sophisticated stuff, the university endorsed Project Rise, and it began to exist. But what Project Rise was before I took the helm of it was just that, a university-endorsed peer support program. No infrastructure, no training, nothing. Now, what that equates to, and now this is as statistic as I get, hopefully. What that equates to is me sending Ava 15 years from now to college saying, when your friend comes to you, help them. Now, if I ask Ava, for instance, Ava, how prepared are you socially, academically, and psychologically to help that caterpillar? She's going to say, very. I'm going to help him. Right? 15 years later, I say, Ava, how prepared are you socially, academically, and psychologically to help the caterpillar? She goes, hey, very. But then I say, okay, here's a caterpillar. This caterpillar doesn't have money to pay for a meal plan, so he can't eat. This caterpillar, because there are no trees here, doesn't have a place to build a cocoon, so he can't sleep. What are you going to do? Now all of a sudden something shifts, right, in Ava, because she doesn't have any idea about what to do with that sort of complicated problem. This is what we're asking our students to do. We bring these very gifted children to us and trust the other children to them without actually upgrading their skills. That's a problem. One of the more sophisticated parts of Project Rise, as I do this research, I asked them those very same questions. How prepared are you psychologically, academically, and socially to help? And what this is, it's a repeated measure design. And you see that there's something like a little V there, right? The first is always high. On a scale of 1 to 5, they almost invariably choose something like a 4 or 5. You know, this is where it is, 4.5. They're just, I'm very prepared. I'm going to help every student who comes to me. And immediately after, I give them a vignette, which includes some random university experience. And then for half of this training that Project Rise is, I focus on awareness of self, awareness of self and others, and awareness of the gifts that you have to offer. And then I reassess, how prepared do you feel psychologically, socially, and academically to help? And you see that's where that dip is. Once I give them what I'm expecting them to do, all of a sudden there's some reality testing. Maybe I'm not quite prepared. After the second measure, I actually do a purely skills-based training. Under these circumstances, this is what I expect you to do. Here's where you go. Here's how you go. Here's numbers. Here's websites. Here are things to say. For instance, I think it was beautiful when you said, you call your friend and you say, hey, look at this microaggression. Can you believe that happened? And they say, yes. That's helpful, but at clinicians, we know it's also helpful for them to say, I'm not sure how you can keep coping when these things happen. Now, that opens the door for a whole nother conversation. This is what I teach students to do. When you observe, here's how you respond. Not discharge, respond. Now, what's interesting to me, and then we'll sort of move through this, the other part of my research is I'm interested in if this self-perception can predict behavior. Before, in this first rating, there is absolutely no correlation between self-perception and decision-making. That makes sense, right? Just because you feel like you know what to do doesn't mean you actually know what to do, which makes a world of sense. At the end, there is a very strong negative correlation between, and this is only significant in the psychological domain, even though the pattern is consistent across all three domains, only in the psychological domain is this significant, and it is this. As students begin to feel less psychologically prepared, does decisions become predictable? Which is what I want. When students begin to feel overmatched, out of sorts, they begin to make the same decisions. We have to have more models where our students can internalize rationale for good decision making. So, Project RISE is a peer counseling service and training model, and it has three components. What's interesting about this intervention is it is a jointly sponsored program between the Office of African American Affairs and Counseling and Psychological Services at UVA. Both departments house it. The first is we have dedicated consultation to both faculty, students, and family. For instance, every year before a student gets to me, I send home sleep diaries. And I'm saying, you know what? Track this with your child. Because even though they won't tell you lots of things, if they are sleeping irregularly, that's something. And that might be something to give to me. You know, so I can teach the family also. Another is there is peer student support services, and this is actually where the students have spaces where they can sit across from other students, where that idea of support actually becomes formalized. I'm acknowledging that I have difficulty, and I'm creating an opportunity to both receive help and, in many cases, give help. And the third is what I find most fascinating is this thing that I'm calling who's helping who's. And somebody said, y'all won't know what a who is. We are the Wahoos. So who's helping who's? Now, who's helping who's is actually a training program, which is a sequence of two courses. The first is peer counseling skills and theory, and the second is peer support program research design and evaluation that is only available to undergrads. And I begin to target first years who I want to take the class before they even get to me. I want to give students the skills to perform these roles that I know they're going to do in my stead. It's beautiful. Now, what's really fascinating about this course? What's fascinating about the course, and that was the first graduating class from the course, some of them anyway. It's a funny thing, because the program, all of this was designed for black students, but over the construction of it, I've created it for all students. So in this course, you may find that it's 90% black, and then maybe 5-6 non-black students in the class. And it's always interesting, because the students don't know what to make of it. Because there aren't many opportunities in our institutions where you can walk into a majority black, majority minority class, and the class has nothing to do with remediation, nothing to do with deficit, and nothing to do with AAS, no slight. And the average GPA in my class is about 3.5. How in the world does that happen in these very rigorous institutions? That in itself is a reality check for other students. I am beginning to work against the stereotype that it is the minority students who are bringing the GPAs down at these places. Because that's wholly not true. It's almost statistically impossible for 1,000 students to create some impact on GPA anyway. But that's what's interesting about this. So the moment I do a training program like this, I am actually increasing the efficacy of interventions. I'm increasing the emotional maturity in all students, and as a service, I'm actually creating opportunities for students for the first time to acknowledge that they are having difficulty. Because the illusion is that everybody's doing well until they're not. And then they just disappear, whether that's into a CAPS or medical withdrawal. But if we can intervene before chrysalis, we're more effective.